Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Vancouver Real. I am one of your co-hosts. My name is Mike Zaremba, and with me is my brother, Andy.
Hello, everybody. Nice to have you with us again. And I'm really excited for today's episode. This is something that probably has been in the works for a little while now.
Yeah. Our guest and I have definitely been back and forth at different events saying, hey, I know you and I want to get you on and got to get you floating. And why don't you come down to our restaurant and drink some cool drinks? And it's been back and forth for a while, but we're finally making it happen.
I like Kava.
Kava's going to be a topic of conversation today for sure.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because we all have similar worlds, right? There's all these different kind of tribes forming in the city right now. There's like man talks. There's, you know, the float house tribe, and there's like yoga and all these different spheres, and they all kind of collide, and everyone kind of knows everybody in the same circles. So it's interesting that it's taken this long to get here.
And as always, we are podcasting here from Float House at 70 West Cordova Street in downtown Vancouver, BC. Beautiful city that we have here. And actually, I want to say this because we never say it enough. I'm going to say it. We also want to always recognize as much as we can the unceded Coast Salish lands that this city inhabits. We don't say it enough on this podcast, but we should say it more. And I'm glad I remembered. And, you know, we do always want to recognize the First Nations people that were here and that basically we share this land with. And there's a lot of kind of reform happening now with the relationships between, I guess, you know, colonial government of Canada and the First Nations people. It's a very interesting time and hot topic right now.
Well, it's interesting because the land that we're on technically is not owned by Vancouver. It's owned by them still because it's unceded. So it's kind of like the people that we conquered this land from are all still here. So it's a bit of an issue.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Yeah.
And I think that's starting to be recognized and known and spread. And I think that's a good thing overall. So recognize that, people. And floathouse.ca is our website. I'm jumping back to Floathouse. If you want to use the promo code recovery, you can save 20% off a single float. So come and check us out in person or online if you're curious.
Oh, should we talk about the London Real Academy really quick?
Please.
Yeah, so I'd like to give a shout out to London Real Academy and, of course, Brian Rose over at London Real. Love what you guys are doing. And thanks for all the online support we're getting all around the world because of our connections through London Real. Had a nice little exchange with Elliot from, he's not Dublin.
Edinburgh?
Edinburgh Real.
Cool.
Paul Hurley, been talking to him quite a bit. Brian has been really engaged with us lately. So big shout out to all you guys and hope to keep connecting with you in the future.
Cool. And one final shout out to Omega Point YouTube channel. We have a friend who helps us behind the scenes. His name's Omid, and he helps us with this podcast. And he has a really awesome, before in the past, I'd say it's a little YouTube channel. It's not little at all. It's actually quite large. He's got several thousand subscribers, I think tens of thousands subscribers, and a very strong Facebook page as well. And for his YouTube channel, Omega Point, where he creates a really interesting, thought-provoking, societal challenging videos that kind of make you think about things.
A lot of Alan Watts and a lot of Terrence McKenna.
Yes, exactly.
Good stuff.
So it's juicy. So go check it out. Omega Point on YouTube, please and thank you. And let's move on. Really excited to finally introduce our guest today. Today we have with us Steve Curtis. You are, what are you, Steve? I don't know. According to your website, steve-curtis.com, you're an entrepreneur, a leader, and an innovator with a passion for business, science, and adventure. Your story is crazy, man. I mean, I'm not even going to just read this. We're going to get into it because you definitely have not had a conventional life that maybe the majority of people would who grew up in Canada. You grew up in Canada, I assume.
Mm-hmm.
You know, well, first of all, before I get in there, welcome to Vancouver Real.
Thanks, Mike.
All right. Because, you know, you dropped out of school at 14. However, why don't we even just start there or before there? Like, what got you to the point that you decided to leave the education system at 14 years old?
Well, I'm sure a little bit like you guys and a bunch of the listeners, I was born a little bit different, I think. In our society today, we celebrate difference, but maybe a decade or two ago, it was a lot more about conformity. And I was one of those kids with a big imagination, a high IQ, and a hard a low ability to pay attention and stay still. So they found me in the hallway a lot, and I really wasn't into school. I felt it moved a little bit slow. I really had a passion for learning, but not in the way that everyone else does.
Right. So you found the style to not really be appealing to how your mind might have worked and how your energy was, eh?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I mean, that's, you kind of hear that from time to time. And, you know, I think school is trying to reform a little bit. I don't really know. I don't have kids. I'm not really tapped into the current education system.
Slowly.
But
slowly.
Yeah.
They're moving a little bit into
right.
a little different attitude as opposed to just the, you know, cut and dry traditional, you know, student teacher, you know, bell rings, go in class, bell rings, leave class, kind of routine.
Well, I think we kind of talked about last show is like it really is a system designed to produce really good workers.
Yeah, pretty much.
You know, very structured. And I think by you leaving when you did and getting into entrepreneurship, in which you started with the Zag Group, and I mean, you had tremendous success with that from a very early age on. It says here, by age of 19 is when you started it. And then you quickly grew that from, well, this is cool, from $500 credit card, you grew it into a firm to $5 million in annual sales in less than 5 years. A decade later, the firm had 135 global staff and $40 million yearly revenue. That's pretty impressive.
How'd you do that?
How did you do that? How did that happen?
Yeah, interesting. I think there are really a couple different parts of the story. So after I dropped out of school, really, I was fired by a desire to prove that I had value. You know, leaving school, I was a bit of an outcast, and a bunch of people made bets that I wouldn't be successful, and so I was fired by something to prove. And really, I think as I grew a little bit older, you know, 14, 15, 16, 17, 19, starting the business, I really started to see how destructive that was, but I didn't know what to do about that. And I think for people that are propelled in that kind of way by that dark energy, if we don't love ourselves, it really can consume us. And that's what it did for me. I would work 100 hours a week, and it was all about proving that I was worthy, that I was worthy of love. Mm-hmm. And my relationships were shit. The company was shit. I mean, we did money. We did revenue. It was great. Right. There were awards, and I had a great lifestyle. But I was totally unhappy. Mm-hmm. And I was an alcoholic, and I couldn't sleep. I used sleeping pills, and I had health issues that came up, like headaches, exhaustion, stomach aches. I progressed into more serious things like IBS. I was 22 with these issues.
Right.
And I thought I was invincible. So the early part really propelled me through those kind of levels, but there was a really high cost.
Right.
And that kind of changed for me when I was 24. I found myself in the office of an oncologist who said that I needed to start chemo in a week for the cancer diagnosis I just received.
What kind of cancer did you have?
So it was a really rare kind, type of non-Hodgkin's lymphoma called the peripheral T-cell lymphoma, okay. Not otherwise specified.
Huh.
I call it an orphan disease. And when I was diagnosed, they thought it was stage one little spot on the skin. But there were a few spots, and I thought they were all kind of related. I got in an argument with the oncologist, who I promptly fired.
Okay.
Which at the time wasn't very smart.
Right.
Okay, now what? But I was able to find another oncologist who ran the group, and he did some biopsies of other spots, and it didn't get better. It got worse. They confirmed that it was stage four.
Wow.
Which meant that it had spread throughout my body, and this particular type had no treatment. There was nothing they could do. And just about everybody died at 2 years. A couple survived to 3 years. But I couldn't find anybody that survived longer than that.
Wow.
So at 24, I got my terminal cancer diagnosis.
Wow. Yeah.
So that would definitely change the trajectory of your life, your values, what you want to do, what your purpose is.
Yeah.
Pretty quick.
Yeah. I mean, we think a lot of things are important until we're confronted with something that really matters. I remember a couple of things. First, being angry at everyone else except me.
Hmm.
And then I remember being angry at me And I mean, the stages of grief, there was denial and all that kind of stuff. But I really came to this realization how much I didn't enjoy living. And I think for a lot of people that become ill, there's some component of that. I think if you really, really love your life, you're a lot less likely to get sick than the opposite, if you don't appreciate what you have. Mm. And so one of the major mobilizers for me was, okay, well, I don't appreciate my life, but if I'm going to go out now, what's my funeral going to look like? How am I going to be remembered? And I don't think I didn't live for anyone other than me. And I imagined, you know, my mom showing up at the funeral and maybe a couple family members, but really, what had I done? What had I achieved in my 25 years that really mattered? And so I really thought about that, and I decided however long I had left, I wanted to do something worthy that would make a difference. And I think that's really where people go. I mean, being selfish in those last couple of days, the people I met who were passing and people that had life-threatening illnesses, it always becomes about others, about like connecting with family and making a difference or serving others. And I think that's one of the gifts of a serious illness or a terminal illness. Hmm. Not everybody receives that gift. Not everybody's open to it. But I decided to get focused on this type of cancer and figure out if I could have an impact and change things. And so I had purpose. I had a direction, a trajectory, and I wanted to figure it out. And so that became a different kind of focus. Mm-hmm. And business became less important, and how much money I was making became less important, and whether people liked me or not, but it was, I'm going to solve this problem. And that changed me in a lot of ways.
So by solve this problem, you mean heal your cancer?
Yeah. Yeah. And at first it was trying to work in the traditional medical model. So get the best oncologist in Vancouver and go to Yale and go to Stanford and UPenn. These were the expert centers that put that quick brain of mine to work on PubMed and pulled down 2,000 papers and started reading them and summarizing them and trying to understand what was going on in science and who the leaders were. And I looked like I was some serial killer profiler with dots and maps all over my walls.
Yeah.
Just totally insane.
Mapping it all out.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, here's this guy in Japan who he's working on a new drug. Like, I got to talk to this guy, but he doesn't speak English. Wow. So let's get a translator. And it really started to stress me out. Mm-hmm. And so I hired an MD. I mean, I had a little bit of resources. So I started looking for a researcher. And it turns out there was an MD that had just graduated from Johns Hopkins, and he was up in Canada and he couldn't practice medicine. So I got an MD for the researcher salary.
Wow.
And 20 hours a week, he started out to help me sort of synthesize. And I just threw myself into it. I went to UBC, bought year one med school textbooks, started doing visual courses online, like university courses in medicine, and read couple hundred books in the area of medicine, everything from Janeway's Immunobiology, which is a requisite for med school or one of them, and all the way through to chakras and energy healing, and just everything was a possibility for me.
It's a really good example of when we find out that something's not working for us in our life, and especially with a guy like you who's got all this energy and this ability, you just busted up whatever paradigm you had to in order to find a solution to your problem.
Mm, well said. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, at first I was stuck in the paradigm. It was, we're going to kill this cancer. We're going to figure out the drug. We're going to fix these mutant cells, these cells that are the enemies. And I was doing visualization of like me going in there and shooting the cells and these violent metaphors. Cause that's what the medical system talks about, right?
Right.
The dysfunction of the body. And as I got closer to the edge of medicine, I met some very credible people, interesting titles like theoretical T-cell immunobiologist.
Wow.
So these people theorize about how T-cells behave and why they behave. And they work in places like Yale or Stanford. I mean, there were people in both those places. And the deeper one goes into medicine, the more we realize we don't really know much about it.
Mm.
And there's an intelligence in the system that we think we're smarter than, But really, it has everything it needs to fix things. And this started to become clear to me, along with the fact that I wasn't going to be able to develop a blockbuster drug in 2 years.
Right.
Yeah. on a million-dollar budget. I mean, it's like hundreds of millions of dollars to get a drug out. And
sure.
I was more likely to die from whatever I was going to inject myself with than anything else.
Right. Wow.
So I started in some of these books I've been reading, like Andy Wild's stuff. He has a book called Spontaneous Healing, and the Institute of Noetic Sciences put out a book called Spontaneous Remission, where they listed 8,000 cases of people that just magically got better from their terminal diagnoses.
Wow.
And so it was doctors, traditionally minded doctors, that wrote case papers on it. And they're like, oh, yeah, so this person was riddled with tumors, and then they got a fever. They went to sleep, got a fever, woke up, and the tumors were gone. And so that's about it. They don't know.
Right.
It's just reported as an interesting thing.
Right. Just this one-off phenomenon.
However, there were 8,000 studies,
yeah.
or case studies.
Exactly. Wow. Exactly.
So that's like screaming to you, okay, like, what is this? How can I use this?
Exactly.
How can I do this? So how did you, like, what did you start to do then? What did you start to do? What kind of changes did you make? And like, how did you do this? Like, you didn't use chemo. What did you do? And, what did you do?
So you talked about the paradigm shift. And I think that's really the opportunity when we get to places where it's a dead end. It's like, we'll just turn around or go on the sidewalk or go through the yard. So what was that paradigm shift opportunity? And those were the clues, those spontaneous remissions. And I didn't exactly know what to do or who the expert was. In health, there's everybody and their dog that has a solution. Everybody makes money from treating people with an illness. And as I started to dig, I found a lot of disreputable people. Mm. But you can't necessarily tell who's disreputable by going on Quack Watch, because there's some really interesting, brilliant people that get put up there.
Right.
So I started to look for the people that had survived from terminal diagnoses.
Okay. So actual patients or people like that. Okay, cool.
Yeah. So I asked Smart. Everywhere I went. It's like, do you know anybody that's ever been diagnosed with something terminal and got better? Nope. Okay. Do you know anyone who might know anyone? Okay, great. I'll write that. What's that number again? Okay, great.
Yeah.
So I started asking everybody, and I started collecting a few. I found a few people, and I sat down with them, and I asked them what they did. And one of my friends, who you might love to talk to sometime, he's incredibly cool. He runs he stepped out of it, but he was one of the founders of Inspire Health. Okay. They're a local integrative cancer program that the government now funds. And he's a pioneer in that in Vancouver. And he talks about it as the aha moment. Gabor Mate has some ways of looking at it too in his book, When the Body Says No, The Hidden Answer to Stress. Mm-hmm. There's this shift that occurs in people. It's a shift in the way that they think about themselves and the way that they think about the world. And my tag for this that I write about in my book is called perception medicine. So how I perceive myself and the world and my relationship to it. And so all of these people had major shifts. They also implemented some different health practices. So I just collected a list and made a checklist. I put that checklist in my book, and before I put it in the book, obviously, I put it up on my wall, and every day when I left my house, I would check the boxes on if I had done these things that they did. Hmm. And as I did these things, I started to see improvement.
Really? How quickly did you start to see improvements?
It took a little bit of time. I think the way I'd lived my life was so unhealthy that it took a while for the body to get better.
Yeah.
So many models of looking at how the world works, right? We think about it like in a quantum physics model, holographic universe, our thoughts, our perceptions are what we see. I mean, that's kind of this 100,000 foot view. If we think about our body and we think about cells, we think about these little, the name cell, like a cell, a jail cell with a bunch of stuff inside. Is how that came about. Mm. And as we got better imaging, we saw there are other things inside. There's like a little brain called the nucleus, and there's these interesting machinery that produce energy and store information. And so when I started in thinking about the body, it was it was little diagrams of T cells and antigen presenting cells and B cells and natural killer cells. And when you look at these immunology textbooks, it looks like battle warfare, like right. military strategy.
Yeah.
And there's just like this little circle and a box and
like
a triangle.
The macrophage is just enveloping another cell and wrapping around it and, you know, digesting it or whatever it does, right?
Well, that's kind of the next level. In the textbook, they just show circles and squares. They're just like they're right. linear pieces of data that fit together. Mm. But I had this remarkable experience where I did something called live blood analysis. You prick your finger, put it on a slide, and look at it 4,800 times microscopy, wow. dark field. And you can watch exactly what you're saying. The cells in your body move and go find a bacteria and envelop it and devour it. And I, as I watched that cell, I had this aha moment that these 40 trillion cells in our body plus or minus a bunch that actually aren't from our body, we have all kinds of things living in our body,
sure.
are actually sentient. And that's fairly controversial, I would imagine, for a doctor that's listening who never really grew up in that paradigm. But I thought of them like people, or like a dog or a pet of some kind.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, who's to say whether it's a dog or a person, or if a dog is smarter than a person? I mean, we build things, but dogs look pretty peaceful sometimes.
They do, yeah.
So I thought about that as a community, and I thought about if these were living creatures, how would I treat them? If this was a country or a community, how would I lead it to bring it back to wellness?
Wow. And what was that leadership? What did it look like? What did it feel like? How did you, what was it like for you?
Sure. So there were some easy things that were things I could do quickly. Maybe I won't say easy. Dropping when I got sick, I was the guy that would order a steak and there'd be some broccoli and some potatoes on the side. I'd push the broccoli onto my girlfriend's plate or whatever. And
yeah.
Take some steak. Of her steak and just steak.
Right.
And I'd eat potato chips and, you know, whatever was really unhealthy. So I became a vegetarian, and then I became a vegan, then I became a raw vegan, and that all happened very quickly. And so I was a raw vegan for 9 months. And I came to subscribe. The scientific validation for this isn't totally there, but acid alkaline balance is kind of an interesting concept that I used to guide my thinking in how I ate. So National Cancer Institute recommends leafy greens. Well, leafy greens coincidentally are incredibly alkalizing. Water source is important, and so I became a raw vegan that had a very alkalizing focus to the diet.
Okay.
Right. Now, I've heard that with that alkalizing theory, that it doesn't really have much to do with diet. It's basically your body will self-regulate its pH levels regardless of what you eat.
Yeah. So our pH has to be in a very narrow band.
Yeah.
It's been a little bit, 7.2 something.
7.2, 7.4, something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe 7.6 in that band.
Right. And if you slip out, you go into a coma and die.
Exactly.
And the coma mechanism actually is part of the survival because the primary driver is breathing. So if you go into a coma and they have you on one of those respirator machines, that's how they control your pH
right.
by how much oxygen you're taking and what the mix is.
Right.
So all that being said, the things we eat are acidic or not, and the body has to balance to keep it in that range.
It has to buffer. So if exactly. you're really, if you're eating lots of acidic things, then your body's going to have to work harder to buffer it.
Yes.
Potentially.
Exactly.
So it keeps you in an equilibrium, but how much more are you stressing the body to maintain that equilibrium?
That's the point they made. They said the alkaline foods won't make you more alkaline necessarily. It's that balance that your body doesn't have to compensate for the alkaline or non-alkaline or more acidic foods. That mechanism, whatever that is, doesn't get as stressed.
Yeah. Yeah, a really unsophisticated way of looking at it is just pH on saliva or on urine. Every time you take a pee, you just hold one of those little pH strips out. And if you have 5.5, you have acidic output from your body, and it's working hard to try and keep you in that range.
Right, that makes sense.
If you're blue, like 7, then you're in that range and it's balanced.
Yeah.
And so I started eating all greens, and I was still 5.5 for something like 3 or 4 months.
Wow,
like it took a while. That built up. And if you think like, what is it that promotes this acidic state? So meat, alcohol, sodas, aspartame, pharmaceuticals, stress, intense workout, shallow breathing. I mean, these are all things that we would say if you wanted to live a healthier life, you would drop. Coffee. Mm. So the raw vegan was peace, and my exercise routine, this angry kid who has to take on the world, I would get out there and I'd sprint full speed at like 150 or 180 beats a minute.
Yeah. I think that's a very important point. Unless you're training for performance for something specific, I think a lot of people do, you know, like there's a pretty big push now, like, you know, people, started to get into physicality, physical exercise, you know, 80s and the 90s and 2000s. And now you're seeing people, you know, CrossFit gyms, good example, like doing very intense exercise kind of just for the sake of doing it. Mm. And I think they're, and this is kind of a little bit of my background. I am a strength and conditioning coach, and I have a degree in human kinetics. And, I came from a pretty intense sports background where I was training at high intensity for performance. Now, after that, though, I've definitely have changed things quite a bit, and I train mostly for functional longevity and just feeling good. And I think that there is something worth saying that I'm not sure how much is being said right now about how intense this quote unquote the regular Joe is needing to work out, because I think you're right. I think super intense exercise, although you're going to probably look fantastic to our, you know, stereotypical norms of what we think beauty is, you might be kind of harming your body actually, and not being that quote healthy necessarily. I think there's, you know, moderate exercise, like you want to have strong lungs and heart, but there's almost that limit that's too far that I think is worth saying.
But you got to think too, with excessive exercise, you're creating a lot of free radicals.
Right. A lot of chemical processes.
Exactly.
Oxidation.
So a lot more oxidation is happening. And that's, of course, ripping a little electrons away from cell or atoms and potentially causing mutations in cells. And so, and it's all about that balance, right? It's all those people who have the longest lifespans are the ones who live on one of those, I think it's Okinawan in Japan.
Right.
Something like that. And the whole thing is they eat very little calories, and they do like a little bit of moderate exercise. They're kind of active throughout their days, and they don't burn a lot of excessive calories. They don't eat a lot of excessive calories, and they tend to have the longest lifespans.
I think another point they had there too is like they had a sense of purpose. So no matter what age they were at, they're like, I go and I take care of the garden,
right?
Or that's whatever it was. Too. I think that was another thing they pointed out, and kind of going back to your, you know, sharing with purpose, like you had this new purpose and you learned, it seemed like you went through a crazy intensive of personal education with all of this. And then, you know, how long did it take from you, starting this process? Let's say once you kind of decided what methodology to take and your approach, your paradigm shifted, to actually get the cancer to go into remission and to be cured. Like how long did that take you?
It was a dance.
Yeah.
So all in about 5 years. And it started with no response. So vegan diet, moderate exercise, calming the mind. So taking up meditation. I mean, trying to, I couldn't. There was just close my eyes and way too many demons screaming around in the dark there. So yoga, that worked. That got me focusing and started building the prefrontal cortex to be able to control and the breathing. Exactly.
That's a great starting point, I think, yoga for a lot of people, right? You're getting that little taste of moving meditation. However, it's not like, you know,
just sitting
for an hour or however long on end, right?
Exactly.
A little easier. Yeah.
And so then therapy. Bunch of self-work, so you name it, Landmark Mastery, Anthony Robbins stuff, family constellations, neuro-linguistic programming, trance work, hypnosis, just discovery of the mind and the various layers and opening each of the rooms and different frameworks and paradigms at looking at how the mind worked.
Yeah.
So as I started to implement those things, I was so fortunate to be able to have the cancer on my skin. And in some ways it was, okay, I can't go to the beach, or I don't want to take my shirt off because I have this cancer and I have to look at it all the time and I'm watching a new spot come and it's like I'm dying, I'm watching myself die. In another way, it's like it's this direct feedback mechanism to how I'm living my life. And so there was no response for a while. New spots kept coming, but it was the only thing I had. I was just going to keep going at it because I wasn't going to make a drug fast enough, and this is what I chose to believe.
Do you think, do you feel there was something in that part of it where you didn't see this instant response necessarily, but like it almost like put you to a test of faith? Like, how much do you believe in what you're doing? Do you think there was any part of that in there that maybe was a catalyst to actually get started?
I write a lot about that in my book. And one of the things I struggled in writing about is, again, like, what framework do we take on viewing the world? So we talk about placebo. So if you believe you are going to become well, you become more well. If you really believe, and in placebo, ritual is important. So we were doing some smudging when right. you came in. And before the whole illness thing was like, oh, what's that for? That's a waste of time and silly and et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
The me now is like, wow, that's beautiful. What's the intention behind that?
Totally.
Because when we watch placebo, the more complicated the ritual, the more steps it is. So get up, pray to the east side 20 times on your knees, and then to the west side, and then make this thing in a special way and offer it to the village. And so it has a much deeper impact the more that's involved in it.
Yeah, and I agree. I think there's definitely something to that. Humans have something, a connection with ceremony and ritual that helps us to maybe get into a more meditative, grounded state, a mind calming state, just by going through these motions that have intentions, that have a meaning behind them to you, you know, and you can make that whatever you want. And that's the beauty of it, really. You know, that's the thing. You can, whatever you want to do, if you're connected with that and you're fully invested into it with yourself, you know, I think there's benefit to it.
That's the thing too. I mean, if you talk about the placebo effect, I mean, if you do have that ritualistic belief and you believe that this is going to heal you, well, then it could aid to that whole placebo phenomenon that goes on, right? I wonder how much, you know, the diet was probably a big part. Changing your lifestyle was a big part. And how much of it was mental that actually made that shift for you, in physical healing, in the actual physical healing that you went through?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think I really lived an experience that could separate the two. I noticed that if I was calm and I ate poorly or I exercised in a way that was way too intense, I noticed that I would still have progression of the cancer. If I ate perfectly and took care of my body perfectly, and slept well, I mean, sleep was another really important point.
Right? Yeah.
Like learning how to sleep for me was quite the process.
Yeah, I've been there
without pills and
yeah. But I found that even if I did all those things right and my mind was off, that I would still have progression.
Interesting. You know, it might be even the fact that you are eating so clean and so healthy and doing everything right that you're like, yes, it adds to the placebo. I'm healing myself right now, right? So it is that kind of ritual through diet, almost like we had talked about, right? Maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. I think there's definitely some science of eating well. And I mean, some of the large organizations have done great work, like National Cancer Institute takes two groups of people and puts one on a plant-based diet and one keeps eating whatever they're eating, and the 85% of calories from meat versus 85% of calories from vegetables. And the vegetables do better all the time.
Yeah, well, I think diet's huge. It's hugely important for sure. Like having super nutrient-dense food is critically important. I mean, that's those nutrients, those antioxidants is what's going to prevent those free radicals from, you know, stripping electrons away from other atoms in your body, and it'll reduce the amount of potential cell mutation going on there. And that could definitely be a part of it, right? So at the very least, you're looking at minimizing damage that might have been going on, right? And again, adding to that whole, I'm being healthy, I'm taking care of myself, this is what I'm doing for my own personal health and wellness. Again, adding to that mental state of I'm doing the right thing. I feel good now. I feel happy with how I'm living my life. And, you know, who knows? It's probably very synergistic.
Yeah, I think so. And I mean, just touching on something you said, I think most of the world thinks about illness, particularly cancer, as genetic abnormalities, something like a cell that divides. And when it divides, it misses a few things. So maybe it misses the gene that allows it to die, or it misses the gene that regulates its growth. So these things go crazy, and a really aggressive cancer doesn't die, and it grows really fast. But then we kind of had this innovation that we called epigenetics. And so what's this epigenetics thing? How does this work? So genes are sometimes on and sometimes off. Sometimes they're actually there, but you can't see them because they're not expressing.
Yep.
And so I think about, and this is part of that consciousness model at looking at cells, every cell as an individual member of a community. If we say like us in the room, we're very peaceful, we're calm here together, but if the building caught on fire or some zombies started attacking, we would be a little bit more intense.
We might get a little stressed out, perhaps. the stress response might kick in, especially when the zombies come. That's the worst.
Yeah, I hate that.
Yeah. Before getting sick, I used to watch a lot of zombie movies.
I just watched the pilot for The Walking Dead the other night, and because I'd never seen that series, and I didn't realize they're they actually walk. They're not like 28 Day Later zombies. That sprint.
Oh man,
those are like, oh, those ones are
28.
Like,
those are scary.
28 Day Later zombies are crazy. What's the one with Will Smith? That one is pretty nuts.
Oh, yeah,
I Am Legend.
Yeah.
You know the one I'm talking about?
Yeah, I Am Legend. Yeah.
Yeah. They're all good. And there was the other one too, with Brad Pitt.
Something Z.
Z Nation. No, that's the show.
I don't know. I don't know. It was another zombie movie where they infected the world and everyone became zombies and Brad Pitt saved the world. Or saved humanity by doing something. I don't know. Yeah, they're fun. It's a fun genre.
But you're right.
However, yes, we would be very stressed out.
Yeah, so these cells, we think about cells like people. And so if we change the environment of this room, the way in which we are experiencing our life, our behavior changes. And we can bring out these tendencies that we don't really have. You guys both strike me. Every time I've seen you as incredibly calm people. But there are probably some situations that would bring out some character traits that are a little bit different. And so cells in the same way. And so I think about these cells as changing their genetic expression. And the model in science is pretty strong. It's definitely pushing the frontier. And it's a sort of war of dogma and paradigm all wrapped up in protective layers. But what we see is that when you change the environment that a cell exists in, it changes its identity. And one of the great authors on this, Bruce Lipton, Biology of Belief.
Yep, so good.
Had some great conversations with him. I debated him on a couple of things because I thought he was wrong. And then I kind of applied it. And I'm like, oh, actually, you're kind of right. Okay, you're really right.
That's what Gabor speaks on a lot, too, is the whole epigenetics and how stress can activate or inactivate certain genes, and that could cause changes in how that gene expresses itself, right?
Exactly.
So, and that's just a whole new field. For example, I just did a whole bunch of genetic testing myself, just in relation to, well, I'm not going to say it on air. I had genetic testing done, and the genetic counselor I was speaking to told me that the information she's giving me now will change in 6 months. Mm-hmm. She's like, it's going to be changed in 6 months. It's going to change in a year. And she's like, you know, based on certain decisions you might want to make in your life, you can come talk to us whenever you want, right? Based on how the information might change. And it's good for them too. It helps their research too. So it's such a new field, you know? So for those people that are just going to write it off as woo woo or whatever you want to call it, I mean, how do you know? I mean, to at least keep the door open, you know?
It's 100% real. And if one looks up epigenetics and gets into PubMed, there's some great pioneers in the field of psychoneuroimmunology that have done some amazing work, taking cancer cells out of their environment, putting them in a test tube, they go back to normal. Seeing changes in the environment, in the body. I mean, the body is a collective community. I mean, it's trying to understand why a country votes a certain way. Like, if Trump got elected president, how did that happen? You know, what were the forces? I mean, it's complicated. It's complicated to explain how something like that could or would happen.
Yeah.
So in the body, I guess, kind of coming back to it, the theory that I developed is that most of it had to do with how I think. And the foundations had to be there. I had to be living, eating well and moving my body well and getting that movement every day. But the molecules of thought, I believed, were the triggers for the epigenetic expression. So we'd say cytokines, hormones, neuropeptides. And as I went to the edge with some of these people in pharma, that's exactly what they were working on. They're like, okay, it's either a viral fragment, a heat shock protein, or some kind of hormone that's triggering these T cells to proliferate. We don't think it's a genetic deletion. So you have an oncologist that's like, these cells are screwed up, they're broken, we need to kill them. And then you have somebody who's inventing the drug in the bowels of Pfizer Japan, not speaking English, but the global expert who's like, no, they're just responding to something. We don't know what. And we're trying to figure out how to block the pathway. You're trying to figure out how to block. What does that mean, block the pathway? Well, we're trying to figure out how to stop it from being there. Okay, yeah. So what do you mean? So, okay, well, if it's a virus, how do you stop it from proliferating? Or it's like moving into the cells and causing these things to proliferate. Sometimes they hijack the machinery. Maybe like if there's some parasites that change human behavior, similar kind of way.
Right.
And then heat shock proteins. Exercising super intense is one of the ways that heat shock proteins get created. Any kind of stressor, you don't eat or you're deprived of water, and it protects the body and the fabric of the body. And then the third, hormones, neuropeptides, those are all molecules of emotion. Those are all chemistry of perception. And so if we're in this room and you guys are looking at me and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, they hate me. They're going to ask me terrible questions. And the people on the camera, they're...
The terrible question part, that's possible. That's completely possible.
I'm an open book.
Yeah. Yeah, that's really interesting.
So, but yeah, so if that's happening, then these neuropeptides are going to be, they're harmful, I assume. Is that what you're saying? Or
well, they change the environment. Okay, so, right. So this theory that I operate on is, okay, the cells are behaving this way. It's super screwed. I'm screwed. I'm going to die. So I'm just going to change everything. I'm doing the opposite of everything that I was doing. And so we talked about the health parameters. But for me, it really became about achieving this place of peace. This place of calmness. And there was one researcher that I met that was profound. I mean, this relates to what you guys are doing here, which is why I was so honored to be here, one of the many reasons. His last name is Hall. I can't remember his first name, Professor Hall. And he works with, he was the National Geographic Medical Mysteries reporter and works with DARPA. The defense research.
Scary robots.
Now robots. Before it was super soldiers, right?
So is that what it was before?
Yeah, like how do you make soldiers live longer? Like, you know, the guy at a Rocky V?
Okay. Also like exoskeleton stuff.
Yeah, that kind of stuff. So his specialty is fast wound healing. And he traveled around the world to look at crazy stuff. And like the Sufi mystics, the whirling dervishes, okay? How they put these spikes through their cheeks and then pull them out and then heal up. In a matter of hours, you can't even see a spike went through their cheek. How does that happen? So he studied that phenomenon, and he sort of bridged. I came across him by looking to hack the body. I was looking at, okay, neurolinguistic programming and hypnosis. If these cells are conscious, can I program them? I mean, we have conscious mind, subconscious mind, autonomic nervous system, immune cells that somehow get instructions. So could I just reprogram that system and downregulate the growth of T cells? Crazy idea. Who in the world could do it? Look in PubMed. Wow, someone did it. Using NLP and hypnosis to downregulate T cell growth.
Wow.
And so basically you're changing the whole way you think, right? So what types of thoughts would you change? Like what kind of mental reformation did you do, like in a nutshell?
Yeah, right. That's what I wanted to know. So I'm like, gotta call this guy. Because he didn't have his protocols. He didn't have how are you changing it? Yeah. How are you changing the way a person thinks? And so I call him up. I'm like, okay, I'm super excited. I've done NLP. I know it works. And I think my T cells are responding to the way I think. So how do I change it? And so he's the super calm guy, much like you guys on the other end of the phone. And he says, so I could help you do that. I could walk you through the protocol that we used to decrease and increase these various cells. And it's some pretty interesting stuff. But in all the work I did and everything I've seen in the world, I actually think it's much easier. He said, the only thing you really need to do to heal is find 1 hour a day of absolute peace, absolute calm stillness, utter peace. And into that, bring with you a profound intention of wellness. So seeing yourself as well, as whole, as healthy, and giving the body time and a place of rest to make that so.
Interesting.
That's super cool.
I would believe that because of how I feel when I do that. For example, I floated yesterday and...
Yeah, how was your float?
It was great. It's always great. I was in there and I was just doing my meditative thing, just going, becoming really, really present, going into my breath, feeling the sensations of my body. And then when I start feeling my body, just the feeling of the cells, I just start visualizing like my body is healing. And I'll even start saying that mentally. I'll start saying, you know, I'm healing this. I'm healing my body right now. Because I always get a little nervous about different things like that. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I feel super relaxed. I can feel every part of my body now. Like it's vibrating in there because there's nothing else to pay attention to. And I'm like, I'm just going to infuse it with like, and I even say like, I love myself. And I'll just say, I'll put love awesome. Into my body too. I'll do that. And I feel like, I don't know. It's a feeling that feels healthy. That's the only way I can describe it.
Feels
good. Feels really amazing. Good. Yeah. And I could totally see why that could, you know, bring on healing, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I totally agree. And I think that's actually something interesting to watch, like in this dialogue, for people to, you know, consider this, right? This is my viewpoint, and my experience. Everybody has a different outlook, but to consider the idea that the way we think and the chemistry that flows through our body has a profound impact on our health. And so then thinking about like what's going on in our body. And before we got on, you asked me, have you come out on psychedelics?
Right.
Yeah. Like there's like a whole DC audience regulatory part to our business. And then there's a part which is like, this is just what happens. And, right. and I'm, I, you know, it's sometimes hard to balance those parts, but
totally.
But yeah, in my book, I wrote about that. And
what's your book called, by the way?
Curing Terminal.
Curing Terminal.
Yeah.
Okay, awesome.
So I wrote it last year.
Yeah. Awesome.
Last year and the year before, and it's been sitting on a shelf for the year as we've been so focused on business, but I'm just focused now on finding a publisher for it and awesome. Getting an agent and stuff. So
awesome.
We have it at the lounge, as cool. Conscious cool. Lounge in Yale Town.
Cool. We should bring it in here.
Okay.
If we can have a copy for our lounge.
Cool. Yeah.
That'd be really cool. Like a sneak preview.
Just switching gears a little bit. How long did it take you to write your book?
45 days.
Wow. You pounded it out.
Every vacation day for 2 years.
Oh, wow. Amazing. And is it just, so what's the premise of the book? How about that?
Yeah. So it's one of the interesting things. So Curing Terminal, the person that it's best for is someone who has an illness or challenge in their life that relates to their health that wants to let it go. And in the book, it's sort of three parts. One is the story of the adventure from diagnosis to becoming well, like what did you do? How did you do it? How did you overcome each of these hurdles? How did you become a raw vegan? Like what was that like? And how did you calm your mind? And how did you find peace? And how did you become happy? And how did you stop getting upset about things and become grateful? So there's that part. There's the science of the things we talk about. So belief and placebo and nocebo and epigenetics and psychoneuroimmunology and how hormones affect these things. And so there's those components. And then there's a little bit about me and how I was created in my life. Cause we all are these complex ecosystems. I call it the belief ecosystem. So if we had a great childhood, we have a different belief ecosystem than someone who had a terrible childhood.
Definitely.
We see the world in a different way. We perceive ourselves and others in a different way. And so I kind of lay myself open in a very vulnerable way about like where my pain came from and how that applied into my life and then how I healed that. And I mean, these things are always there, right? So it's not like, I always have the challenges, just an awareness of consciousness too.
It's really great that you're so open about it too. Because I think some people, who knows, might be shy to share their experience and really open up about all the things that you did. However, you know, it could be a source of inspiration for anybody out there who's going through the same thing. You know, they could read your book and be like, you know what, I'm going to do, you know, I definitely wouldn't say go away from the traditional, you know, medical sciences. However, why not explore all these other options while you're doing that?
Yeah. I think reading the book, you can combine with a conventional treatment.
Yeah.
I think if you're in a place where you think a lot about your health or you have parents that have had issues with cancer or MS, as Gabor talks about, a lot of that isn't the lineage of genetics, it's the lineage of the psychology of a family. And I think that's brilliant. I mean, I definitely see that. Because these contracts, these belief ecosystems are as real as anybody's genetics and even more real because we see that we can modulate genetic expression.
Mm-hmm. On those beliefs, so you said you went through like Landmark. How far did you go with them?
I just did the opening, the forum for Landmark.
Okay. Because those kind of courses are really good for changing beliefs,
mm-hmm.
right? So do you think personal development work and all the different avenues that you've explored there aided in your healing as well?
Absolutely.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, it's breaking down these barriers and these walls that we create. I am a terrible person. I am not good enough.
I'm not worthy of X, Y, or Z.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And these are real. And they're really fucking visceral. They grab us and they take over our life at times. And sometimes we're great. You know, we're in a great relationship. And then we move into something that just triggers us or a period in our life. And it brings the worst out in us. And I mean, that's something that all of us deal with. And so I think as we go through these development courses, we see that everybody's just like us, first of all. So there's nothing to hide. It's like right. we all have yeah. a monster under the bed.
Yep, totally.
We also have a saint.
right.
And so what contributes to us being those things and how does that relate to our health and happiness?
Exactly. I mean, in those courses, I've done pretty extensive work like that myself, just not with Landmark, different company,
mm-hmm.
Similar stuff. You get to explore those potential monsters under your bed. You can actually express them in an environment that's not going to have any consequences, pretty much. You can say what you need to say, get feedback on those things, potentially change your beliefs. Once you get those out, you know, it's all that transformation process. It's all part of the transformation process of thinking more positively, about yourself, becoming more caring, more loving, more kind human being. And all those things. I mean, like you said, it's like, it's so multifactorial, like all the things that could have contributed to your healing. However, it's going to be interesting down the road where people who are into these kind of things, like, you know, being raw vegan, someone who meditates, someone who is into all of that and see how much longer, you know, they potentially live or, you know, the rates that group might get ill in different ways. And because it's an interesting lifestyle that's very prevalent in Vancouver, and it'd be, I don't know. I mean, if you need to study that and see in the long term how that kind of lifestyle changes people's health.
Mm-hmm. I think there's a couple studies that have done that, and we definitely see the correlations with diet. China study is great for sort of an aggregation of some of that science, and there's critics to everything, but I think it makes a really great point and selects some really great studies for that.
Yeah.
The internal mindset is a lot harder. It's really hard to define what peace and happiness looks like.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a lot of people have no clue how unhappy they are. They're just like, oh, this is life.
Right.
A lot of people, man.
I think that's a huge point.
Like, you know, we had the guy, Philip McKernan for the speaker series come on.
Right.
And he was talking about how people just wear masks and they just hide.
Yeah.
And he also talked a lot about how people will just live with pain, physical pain, emotional pain. And they'll kind of just numb themselves out to it and be like, just the way it is.
Right.
You know? And again, like, doing something different, taking a course, doing some meditation, going to a yoga class,
and it's funny,
changing your peer group, who you're hanging around with. All those things are going to help switch that mindset just a little bit, you know, that little shift.
I think our culture and our society today is, I think, very reflective of where we're kind of at as a species, as a population, as a whole, in terms of like the activities we choose to pursue and the pastimes and the habits that we partake in, especially, you know, with alcohol culture and how popular nightlife is and just, you know, those are huge, gigantic industries that people, you know, are a part of and choose to spend their money with.
Like it totally promotes the, I'm going to work 80 to 100 hours a week and, you know, that's what I need to do to feel successful in this life. And that's what's put on us a lot of the time. So just that burnout culture alone, you know, of even working 40 hours a week. If you're working 40 hours a week in a job you hate, man, that can't be healthy.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So, I mean, do you work a lot less now than you used to?
You know, it's a really interesting question. So when I got sick, I was 100 hours a week. And then I dropped it to 70 and 40. And then to 10. And I mean, I had a lot to figure out. So it was about learning and about getting things right. And then I slowly ramped up again and I became very passionate about making a difference. It's like, okay, wow, this actually happened. 5 years in, the cancer was gone. There was no trace of it. And then it's like, okay, well, it was supposed to die 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years. Okay, 6 years, 7 years. okay, I guess I should write a book about this.
Fuck
okay.
Yeah.
Here's what I did. Now we're 10 years.
Yeah.
It's an amazing story.
10 years. Yeah.
And it's like, sometimes it's like, is that real? You know, like, did that actually happen?
Yeah.
When you get the book, you'll be like, oh my God, it's 200,000 words. It's like, wow, it's a tomb.
That's a beast. That's a beast of a book. Yeah.
I think there's like 20 pages of scientific references in the back. So it's well researched.
You know, what a great message to put out there, because again, someone in your position, you know, you do have some weight behind your words for sure, because of your experience, because of what you've done in the past and what you've gone through. And I feel like our culture does not promote that nearly enough. I feel like medical science does not, just ignores it completely. No, they won't even look at it. You know, they won't even look at it. I mean, when I've dealt with medical professionals in the past, it's just so clinical. It's just, you know, this is what you have. This is what it is. You know, this is what we can do. You have this percentage of survival.
My first oncologist didn't want to read the paper I brought in that said, hey, maybe I'm stage four and doing chemo doesn't change my overall survival time. Why do I want to be puking on my knees and absolutely getting another cancer 5 to 10 years from now if it doesn't actually work? Like, how am I supposed to get better if I'm ripped to shreds? You know, he wouldn't read the paper.
Yeah, it's so cool. It kind of speaks to that conditioning that we're all in, right? You know, we're put in this education system that says this is the way it is. They get taught that, you know, empirical evidence, science-based, you know, that's the only real approach you can take. You go on to university, you go on to medical school, and that's been so ingrained in you, and then that gets reinforced in medical school probably harder than anywhere else. You know, I understand the logic behind it and how they want to be fact-based and they don't want to prescribe something that they can't prove, essentially. However, I mean, it just closes the door to potential, to opportunities that could be super beneficial, right?
Yeah, and it's vicious. It really is. Your question about work, right? So okay, it happened. I'm writing the book. Okay, I'm passionate about plants. Part of the story, we'll talk about it in a little bit, but part of the story was connecting with healing plants and how plants made that difference. And so I decided to translate these things I had into a business and really apply myself. And so it's like, okay, that's fun, that's purpose driven, but there's so much resistance out there that the bigger you get, the more resistance there is. And there was a place where we weren't on the radar, and then we're on the radar, and then we're consuming the radar, and then we're popping out of the screen. And so there's people that watch the radar. I don't know, you know, there's conscious process to it and there's unconscious process. Like, we take pharma and the cancer industry, it's a $1 trillion business.
Right.
Like, it's big. It's a big sale when someone gets a cancer and they got to sell their house for $300,000 to afford the treatment because they don't have medical insurance and because that's how much that drug costs. That's a big sale.
Yeah.
That's a lot of money.
A lot of money.
So we've pioneered into the space, and one of the groups I started, Perception Medicine Foundation, every couple of times a year, we bring people together from the medical field, and we've really been trying to work on a pioneering study. I have a vision to bring a bunch of terminal cancer patients together and apply best practices around the world and see what kind of outcome we can create. Can we reproduce what happened to me? Can we have a positive impact? I mean, in the worst case, people die happier.
Right.
Worst case.
Right.
Yeah.
In the best case, we create an example that what I'm talking about and what I experienced and what I know firsthand and what the people I met know firsthand is real. But what I noticed with a lot of these people who had this experience is they just kind of dropped out of society because it's so scary to be confronted with life and death. And it came from an intensity to drive forward on something. And so they're like, I don't want to be intense anymore. I want to be peaceful. I want to be what Professor Hall said. I just want to have my hour day of peace. And when you're pushing that edge up against this massive unconscious process, against active enemies that throw spears from the dark, it's challenging.
Totally.
And so in the past couple of years, I would say actually I've become a lot unhappier. And it's one of the things I'm really just coming to an awareness of now as the business scaled to $100 million run rate. That's a totally different thing.
Right.
And if it's something that's pretty normal, like you're buying real estate or renting out apartments or a simple software app, great. But if you're pushing up against these big businesses, I mean, some of our botanicals are about pain. They help people to alleviate pain, come off addiction, and these are amazing. But that threatens a massive business and an ecosystem of people that care about profit more than anything
else. So
you're
saying that's where the analogy of throwing spears from the dark came from a little bit?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, there's massive PR firms that their whole purpose, and we see it in the oil industry up here.
So gross.
Wow. Like,
Trudeau got elected. Yeah. Amazing, right?
Right, yeah.
But like the people that are deployed to shape and manipulate. I have a friend that is with Greenpeace, and she told me that this has actually been validated. Joel Solomon is great. Have you had him on this
show? Nope.
I'll help you get him. He's okay. Amazing.
Cool. Awesome.
He's a freedom fighter from the front. He runs a venture fund that invests in businesses that make a positive difference.
Cool.
And so, like, our government, I'm going to totally sound like a conspiracy nut right now, but
it's okay. You can go there.
We've been there before.
Yeah.
The intelligence system under the Harper government deployed intelligence officers to get into relationships with women that were in prominent positions in Greenpeace intentionally to destabilize that ecosystem.
Wow.
That actually happened.
Yeah, this is real stuff. CIA does stuff like that too. I mean, it's preserving the power structure.
It's crazy. Well, there's stuff like that's real, like that's out there, like Bill C-51, where, you know, the government can essentially go in and open any email they want, listen to any phone call they want, listen, go into your phone, go into your computer, you know, at will. You know, that stuff exists. You know, I wouldn't surprise. Well, I'm surprised about that. That's like,
I was too. It's the most surprising thing I've heard, but
right. You know, that's something you might hear out of, like, you know, the Stasi from Eastern Germany or something like that. That's what it sounds like.
Yeah. To preserve this power.
The more you look, the more difficult it is. And I think we have this concept in our society, conspiracy theory, because we actually don't want to believe that we live in a world that behaves this way.
That has malicious intent, right?
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. Like, for example, I wanted to go into that, the PR firm thing. Like, I don't know that world very well. And are there firms out there that are like, just take down firms essentially, or like maybe not, that's not all they do.
Whatever, muddy
that's
water
part
firms.
Of what they do.
Yeah.
So that's out there.
Yeah. Yeah. So we opened an office in DC and we grew there. And, there are, a number of firms that their whole job is to distort reality in the direction that you as the client want it to be. And the best example, there's a couple books on this. A great book is Merchants of Doubt.
I'm gonna write that down right now.
It's a documentary. You can find it online, Merchants of Doubt, and they have a book. And it'll go through it'll go through the whole climate change thing, right? So 99% of scientists agree that climate change is real. 1% don't. And it's one group that funds that whole thing. You have tobacco.
All the misinformation you're getting around climate change is from this group.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's an ecosystem of organizations. And same thing for tobacco. So it goes back over that past. Tobacco, pharma, big oil, these are the organizations that bend reality. Another great book. It's a bit of a technical read. Bending Science.
Bending Science.
Insane. Okay. It's about how, say, it has a public health policy slant. So think about like asbestos, DDT, cigarettes, petrochemicals. And it outlines, this author outlines how these powerful organizations with massive amounts of resources create science that drives the outcome that they want.
Wow.
Wow.
Yeah,
it's
totally.
It's so immoral.
Yeah.
Like, it just is.
And that's the thing, because now, in our day and age, science is like what people trust, right? It is the authority. It is the religion. It's like, well, that's science. You know, it's been through this peer-reviewed process. And you're right. Like, there's ways to manipulate that, and they're doing it for sure.
When all your peers are paid directly or indirectly,
right?
We keep introducing new laws that try and create transparency, but then there's just a new response to it that hides the engagement.
Crazy.
You know, like an unrestricted grant to a university for a very large figure will bias the people in that university to continue to shape in a particular direction.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Like, it's such a big scale stuff. It's I don't even want to believe it exists. I mean, I'm sure it does. I'm sure it does exist, like you're explaining right now. It's such an indication of how messed up, like, a lot of our culture is right now. You know, it's such an indication of what's kind of wrong. And I just couldn't fathom how somebody can go home and be like, I'm good with this. I'm good with like lying to the public and potentially putting them on a more harmful path for profit.
I don't have kids or family yet. If I did, and that was the area I evolved into, and I looked at them and I thought I have to bring home the bread and so they could eat. I mean, I couldn't do it. I would rather die or be destroyed than submit to something that I don't believe. But I think people can slip into that frame. And when you're in an ecosystem of like, I work in this company and we have pride. I mean, we think about yeah, tribe. Nazi Germany, right? Yeah, tribe, right?
It becomes people. A culture, right? And I had something really good to say, and I forgot what it was right now.
You have a lot good to say.
Thank you. I appreciate that. It just slipped my mind. There's something along the lines of the ecosystem and tribe and culture. It's like, yeah, I mean, it starts fueling itself, right? I was going to say, you know, when it comes to doing wrong to get ahead or, you know, when you look at petty crime, for example, well, that's almost understandable in a sense. Like if you're stealing something to... let's say feed your family, or even if you're doing it to feed an addiction. Well, the addiction is not a good thing, and stealing to feed the addiction is definitely not a good thing. However, it's all just kind of pain and illness. These guys have taken it to a whole different scale, where like their whole profit motive is just like, we're gonna just rape and pillage as many people as we can and destroy as many reputations as we can and throw, you know, like you said, spears from the dark to make money. And they're okay with that somehow. And deep down, if you're doing that, how can you be a happy person?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a good question. I think that the truth is hard to define. And we're a product of our environment in the same way we think about like the illness patterns in our body. If we grew up in a family that was angry all the time, that was very unhealthy, and we never got out of that circle, it's hard for us to see anything different. Mm. And so I think anybody who has a mutual fund, unless they know exactly which fund that is and what it's investing in, is part of the problem. We just want our return. We didn't get our 4%. We didn't get our 7%. We didn't get our 9%. What the hell? That guy should get fired.
Right.
So that guy's working hard to make sure he picks the things that are going to return, and that's moving down the system. And I mean, so somebody that like you take a drug like OxyContin, hey, there's some people that are in some serious pain. It saves them from their pain. That's a great product. Okay. Well, collectively across opiates, there's 30,000 people a year that overdose. There's a whole bunch of people that just drop out of society that are enslaved. Yeah. And so like there's one mindset which is like, hey, we got to help this pharma company stay on the market. Otherwise people don't have a pain solution. And then there's another part that
happens all the time. It's fun. Sorry. I interrupted your flow.
That's all good. Honestly. They're excited about what we're doing.
Yeah.
there's another part which is seeing the darkness. So I think it's perspective, it's debate, it's public policy. But you're right, there is a part where truth is not the objective. And I think that's complicated. And I think as a person who's pushing the front, that comes up all the time. Because it's like, okay, you got a paper that can't, you did a study and it comes up and it didn't show the right results. It actually showed something that you wouldn't want to see. Do you release that paper and have like the sword of Damocles come down on your head? Or do you do a couple more studies and see how that balances out? Do you withhold that? Mm. And so there's some fairly complicated things. And I think when you're pushing in that environment, it becomes corrosive. I think some of the people I met in Washington, there are very few people that go to Washington thinking they're going to be corrupt and serve profit. They all go there wanting to make a positive difference.
Sure. Yeah.
But then you realize if you don't vote for somebody on this bill that you know is wrong, they're going to kill your bill that you know is right. Mm. So you got to vote
on
the
lesser of the evil kind of thing.
Yeah. And eventually it's all just horse trading and
man,
house of cards.
So, so what do we do? What is the answer?
Well, that's what I was going to ask.
No
you.
Idea.
Like, what are some?
How do we fix this?
Well, here's the thing. You said you spoke of like, you know, people have these beliefs. It came from their belief ecosystem growing up. From your personal experience, what have been the biggest things? I mean, yours is kind of unique because you've had a terminal terminally ill cancer diagnosis to force you to shift. But maybe even in that process, what have been some of the things that you've done that have been the most impactful on shifting your belief and shifting your mental paradigms and understanding of reality and who you are and how you relate to existence? What are some of the things that maybe have been the biggest impacts on you personally?
Well, we talked about self-work and any of the programs that I mentioned. Or, I mean, one of the great ones I did was Mastery of Self-Expression. It's a guy in LA and Vancouver, and they have a series of courses, and he's amazing at breaking people through their barriers. When I was diagnosed, I went there, and it just shedded a couple layers instantaneously. Brilliant. Larry Gilman is the teacher. Gilman or Gilmore?
It's the bell for some reason.
Yeah, it does ring.
Yeah, he is a master. So I'd say doing the internal work and really, like, wherever we find friction, exploring that. I write a lot in my book about looking for that resistance and tension, and wherever it's edging us, to really understand what's behind that. And I think that's where time in silence applies. Like, the whether you're floating or meditating or starting with a yoga class, I think being able to calm the mind is a real discipline, and unraveling that. I have not done ayahuasca, and I think this is the year.
Good for you. Cool.
But in my healing journey, I did do a hero dose of psilocybin, magic mushrooms. And I write about it as one of the most difficult experiences of my life. Dude. I was dark, and it was hell for a couple hours. It was the worst experience I could imagine. But after that came a profound insight that, hey, that's what my life is like.
You know what? Yeah, I mean, we did that fairly recently, and I took a pretty heroic dose myself, a little over 5 grams.
Yeah.
And it was, again, I went through some personal hells and things that were going on in my life that I struggled with for a long time. And it had been there, you know, and are still there, actually. However, it was, I was going through, you know, thinking in my mind of, you know, how can I fix this? How can I change this situation, as difficult as it is? And it was like doing that was creating a lot of confusion. I was getting more and more upset when I was attempting to think about what the solution is for that. And it came to the point where I had a more or less a forced surrender, where I just surrendered and really had that true surrender of accepting this is just the situation right now, just being okay with what it is for right now. And once I had that, it changed. It flipped my whole experience. Yeah, I was in hell for a couple hours, and then I flipped it, and then I was in bliss after that. So I'm guessing your experience was similar to that.
Mine was just hell until I fell asleep.
Okay, straight hell. Never mind. No bliss. I had a happy ending.
I noticed that. I noticed when I was driving home the next day. I'd normally listen to some loud music and just drain it out. I was coming back from Whistler, and an hour into the ride, it was just silence. Mm-hmm. And I had this calmness over me, and it was the calm after the storm. And it just came as a profound insight.
Cool.
That what I experienced was my life. And when I was trying to figure out what was going on under the surface, I just suppressed it. Yeah. I mean, like we talked about, many people just become acclimatized to
the pain.
The pain, yeah.
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 You know, our mutual friend Crystal, you know.
Yeah.
I was dealing with these issues before, and she knew about them. So she was interesting to go along this journey, and she was kind of there for it. And after I had that moment of just great acceptance and I kind of felt that peace, the funny thing is, after that happened, the situation, maybe it's myself or maybe it appears to be getting better, you know, and I've shifted and the situation's getting better. And also definitely my attitude towards the situation has gotten a lot better.
Love it.
And it was like that force, like, you got to accept this shit for what it is right now. That's what it came down to. You know, and that's ultimately like such a huge lesson, right? We have to accept sometimes all the things that we don't like.
I think you guys are both primed for ayahuasca, in my personal opinion, right now. I've been very fortunate to be able to do it quite a bit. And I think absolutely. I mean, it's an incredible medicine to be able to work with. And I feel extremely fortunate to be in a position in my life that I'm able to go down to Peru to do it many times. And it's just, it's a game changer for me, for sure, you know. And I'm going back again this year for sure, just because I know that there's still more for me to get from it. I believe that. And consequently, on the flight home, there was a big delay, and the airline I was with gave me a flight voucher. So I'm like, all right, I guess I'm going back for sure now.
I love it.
Awesome. Yeah, sure enough, it was a pretty tough.
Would you go back to the same place?
I'll go back there for sure. Yeah, I really love working with the men there and the whole group, and then there's another one that I'm really interested in as well. But I'll go to both.
Is that the Temple of the Way of Light?
Yeah, Temple of the Way of Light. I'll go there. I haven't been there, but I hear it's great. I just feel it. I know it's gonna work out really well. So I'll join both.
You. Yeah. Well, and maybe we'll all go at some point.
I'm going in December. So.
Yeah, well, you were doing that work. I was doing a lot of like the personal development work, and now I need to flip and kind of go into that work a little more.
It's all personal development work, you know. Really, it is just different methodologies, kind of different, you know. But it's incredible stuff to me. I can't believe it exists. You know, it's so profound and impactful and special not even educated, that I can't believe it exists. It's absolutely a wonder to our world. It's the eighth wonder of the world in my mind, you know. It's incredible. So I'm looking forward to hearing if you do make it down. And what would you go to Peru to do it, or would you do it up here, or have you even thought about that?
That's probably a good idea. Go to source.
Oh yeah, the jungle itself. It's going to the Amazon. She is alive. And you seem to be very fond and affinitive to plants. Well, that's like that ecosystem of plants there is the mother lode for sure, and you feel it, and it's alive and it's conscious. And then when you ingest ayahuasca and, you know, meet that spirit or that energy in that setting, see what's happened. It's incredible. It's incredible. It was for me, but it's a process too. It's a process. You gotta kind of respect the where it goes and how long it takes, and everyone's unique and different. It's you. It's all about you and that merging with that consciousness, with that energy. So, if you need any advice, let me know.
Great. I'll
do my best. Not that I'm pro or anything, but yeah.
You're pretty pro.
No, man. I mean,
that's true.
It's all relative, but I want to get into, we haven't even talked about it at all, we're going to go
out.
So, you
know, we're at a minute, we're an hour 17 right now. So
cool.
I don't know how long you want to go for, however, whatever you guys.
Well, I want to talk about Zend Conscious Lounge.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, of course. Thank you.
Newest going to Zend. Yeah. And I was there for the opening night. Congratulations. But so you're the founder of Zend Conscious Lounge. Why don't you tell people what this is all about? It's a restaurant, it's a lounge, but it's a. It's very different. So please enlighten us with that.
Sure, sure. So when you asked me, how do you become well? How do you improve your life? I probably should have said, just come to Zend Conscious Lounge.
There you go.
it's really translating the things I learned in the healing journey into, people call it a restaurant, but I really see it as a movement. It's a physical space in Yaletown. We started in the heart of the location where people are known for drinking a lot and consuming lots of indulgent food, meat and cheese and
shopping, materialism.
Sure, exactly, right? So so opening a plant-based food restaurant. So we started calling it vegan, which scares everybody off. I don't want to go to a vegan restaurant. It sounds like a bunch of vegetables. But we've made our food very appealing. It's
well, I've been there. Okay. I went there for Mike's talk, and it is delicious food, man.
Thank you.
And again, I was a huge fan of the kava. Love that stuff. I don't even know how it works. However, it's awesome.
Yeah. So so that's the second pillar. So really, three pillars of our philosophy. One is healing food. The second is we don't serve any alcohol. We serve a drink we call Zend, same name as the restaurant. And we have a couple different forms of that, but it's a very particular type of kava. Kava Kava is an herb that grows in the Polynesian Islands, Vanuatu, Samoa. If you have any Fijian friends, they probably know it. Or if you've been to Fiji, you've tried it. It's a natural anxiolytic. Health Canada lets us say feel calm.
Okay.
That's about the
that's all you can say.
Description.
Yeah.
But it might be psychoactive. You can't say that. I can say that.
You said it.
Yeah.
So it has a noticeable feeling, and it is perfect. Traditionally, people use it. They sat in a circle at the end of the day, and they drank it as they talked about their day, and it has a very calming effect. You feel good. It relieves the stress. Interestingly enough, that herb, when you compare it to anti-anxiety drugs in clinical studies, the right type, which is what we focus on, is as effective as benzodiazepines or a brand like Xanax or whatever that may be. Wow. I think I feel the letter coming from the trademark owner of Xanax.
No. So
it's a drink that really I describe takes us out of our mind and moves us into our heart. It's either body or heart. But we have this hamster that runs on this wheel, most of us all the time, and we don't know how to turn it off, so we just suppress it. We drink a bunch of booze and try and shut it off, but it's still running. We just forgot that it was there. Whereas Zend, this formulation, calms that process. And we have this great game on the table called Conscious Connections. So you share it with somebody, and it might be a team share, 30 seconds, everybody around the table, the most exhilarating moment of the past year of your life, or a goal you've set for yourself that you don't know you can achieve, and how people could help you achieve it. Mm-hmm. So who talks about that at dinner with a group of strangers?
Right.
Once you've had some Zen, you feel a little more open. You're not worried. You're like, hey, here's how it goes.
I think I might have to have a bottle of that tonight. Okay. I think so.
We will have a bunch.
Awesome.
Up to the 125 milligram recommended and approved dose.
Perfect. Awesome.
Unless you guys choose to pour your own, I can't stop you.
Right. I might have to go there. Yes. Sounds good.
So the third pillar is part that I'm really excited about in the movement piece. I didn't start this to make a profit. I started this to make a difference. And community was really the biggest part of my healing adventure, spending time with amazing, conscious, supportive people like both of you that just show up and say, hey, that's good, and you're good, and I want to help, and I want to help you find it. Like, what you guys do here for people all the time is a gift to the world. And so connecting with those kind of people, that's who we attract. And we have a couple events. Every Tuesday we have Zen Talks. We have a speaker come in and share.
Sure. Yeah, which I got the great pleasure of doing so maybe a couple months ago now.
Yeah.
It was fun.
Amazing really fun. Reviews.
Cool.
Yeah. And I regretted missing it. It was fantastic.
You know what I really like about what you're saying is that, so you have the, you know, the restaurant aspect of it, the business aspect. However, you have an underlying message behind the whole thing. Mm-hmm. And I can completely relate to that. And that's exactly what we talk about quite a bit here. Mm-hmm. How the, you know, float tanks are great. It's a tool. It's something that's going to help you meditate. It's going to, you know, it's a different way of meditation. However, you know, there's a whole underlying message behind what we do here. And if you kind of follow the social media and what we talk about and even the podcast, it's all kind of pushing this one similar direction, which I feel like is very similar to the direction you're pushing.
I think so. Yeah.
And what is that direction? Well, if I was going to sum it up in a word, it'd be like, well, peace, harmony, being kind, spreading love, compassion.
Yeah.
All that direction.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
We say happier, healthier people. I think it's easier to be happier when you're healthier. And when you're happy, you generally have started to get a glimpse of peace. I think peace is kind of a profound thing to attach to food. I think it's a little tricky.
Right.
But ultimately, that's the destination. Mm. And the last piece I actually wanted to share about the lounge, if I might, there's two other things. One, on Friday nights we do what we call a conscious dance party. So no alcohol. People are connecting and dancing. It's remarkably fun. It's amazing to see what people are like.
Well, perhaps I'll have to stick around then.
Yeah. We'll work on that. And then Sundays we have a charitable event. Anybody from the community comes in, 10 to 12. We're doing something different every week. 3 weeks ago it was random acts of kindness. Going out, giving people hugs and making children laugh and helping people cross the street or whatever that may
be. That's fun.
And then we had a beach cleanup last week. I actually wasn't very excited about that one. I was like getting out of bed and I'm like, clean the beach, pick up garbage. I don't know. But it was remarkably fun because it's a bunch of people doing something good on a Sunday morning where instead you could be hungover. In bed thinking,
we did a beach cleanup last year out in White Rock.
Yeah.
And... I don't think I've done one since like Boy Scouts or something like that, you know, and it was fun. You're just walking around the park and picking up garbage. And then you actually kind of like, look at this one. Look how big this is. You know, you kind of
get
into what you're finding.
Exactly. And this week We are making sandwiches and handing them out in downtown East Side. Awesome. So we've doubled every week. This is our third week doing this. Finally, we've implemented it.
So do you run these programs, or is it someone really running it for you?
Yeah,
or?
Ashley is a partner and GM at the lounge now, and and she organizes it and runs it, and I usually come and participate.
That's awesome.
Much easier to just be a participant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, if you can, definitely delegate some work out, it's a good thing.
More support, more inspired leadership. She's an amazing
awesome
woman.
Cool. So, and then Zend Conscious Lounge, like, what's your future vision for this in terms of, like, you know, where do you think it could go? Like, where do you see it? What's your personal aspirations behind it all, and the movement of Zend Conscious Lounge?
Sure. So so first location goal is to, I've always thought about it as a spiritual hub for the community. Almost a lighthouse. People move to a city, or they wake up one day and they're like, I'm done with this life. I don't want to be hung over every Sunday morning. I want to meet people that take me on this journey of a better life. And so I want to be that place for people. And I just think about the lighthouse that helps people into the harbor where they want to be. Mm. And really, like, I spent a lot of time in the past thinking about, oh, how much, what's our revenue, what's the goals. Now it's just about touching those individual people. And I'm seeing that now, and that really inspires me. But obviously scaling that into different locations. And I describe it as a movement. I mean, us getting to that rhythm and that heartbeat and that DNA of something that people just really get that deep personal benefit from. And us taking our drink that we've created there and moving that into an option in the world. Because I think, I sometimes look out from my window in my apartment and I think, what would the world look like if everybody wasn't overdosed on caffeine all the time? You think about Starbucks, like 75 milligrams is approaching that overdose. There's a great book called Caffeinated. If you're curious about caffeine, if you drink caffeine, if you have trouble sleeping, read that book.
Maybe I'll check that one out too.
75 is like a dose. People can detect caffeine at 1.5 milligrams. Sure. But if you get a big double at Starbucks, it's 380 milligrams.
Wow.
Sometimes. Wow. There's like a balance of like, it could swing by 100 milligrams.
You're out.
And so you're crazy overdose. And there's lots of people, they stop drinking caffeine, they sleep perfectly.
Yep.
When I couldn't sleep, I had having like 8 cups of tea a day. So what does it look like when we're not super high strung, when we're not edgy, when we're not anxious, when we're not trying to jump at the bit all the time? How much easier is it to meditate or float?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How much easier is it to sleep, to get that sleep we need? And I also look out and I say, what's it like if people weren't drinking alcohol? If we think about all the atrocities that happen under the influence of alcohol, what would it look like?
Super
and if people were drinking Zend instead, what would that look like? I think if we think about the best example of the power of Kava in this particular type, this nobility version of Kava, two warring tribal leaders in Polynesian society about to annihilate each other's villages and families. Before they went to war, they had to sit around and drink a big bowl of Kava. If they still wanted to go to war after, it was okay. But there wasn't a lot of war, because after you drink that, you just want to hug it out, feel good about everything. And that's kind of my vision, is to bring this ingredient and this brand and the formula into the world.
Very cool.
To make it a choice for people that are trying to get to the place they want to go. So we're not giving them a drug that temporarily relieves their pain, but a botanical, a dietary supplement that really doesn't have all those side effects of pharmaceuticals, that can help them live in a way where they're now open to these experiences, where they have almost more courage to embrace their truth and connect with their heart and connect with others, which then is just this sort of spiraling or rolling snowball that just gets bigger and better all the time.
Wow.
Beautiful.
No, that's super inspiring. Yep. I feel like I just met somebody on a similar mission to us right now,
yeah,
which is so cool. And it's amazing it took this long to connect. I don't really know how that... I mean, we've kind of been under the radars for a while.
People.
Actually, when I saw Zend the first time, I had finished a yoga class at Y Yoga, yeah, and I was walking through Yale Town. I'm like, what is that place? I'm like, I think I texted you right away. I'm like, there's a place called Zend Conscious Lounge.
Well, and then I saw it online first, and I emailed right away, and I connected with one of the managers at the time.
Yeah,
I'm not
sure
if they're still there. And then we set up a meeting right away, and I just knew. I knew as soon as I saw it, I'm like, we have to work with these people. It was pretty instantaneous.
Do something anyways. Yeah.
Hey, and support, now we're here.
Support, now we're here.
Amazing.
Doing Vancouver real.
That's right.
Cool.
Getting real.
Well, let's wrap it up. That was awesome.
Excellent. Anything else you want to get out there?
No, I think that's great.
Yeah. So, zenconsciouslounge.com. What's the website?
Yeah, so zenlounge.com.
Okay.
And I'm Steve at zenlounge.com.
Cool.
And I just encourage anybody who's listening, who's interested in any of this stuff, to come by. They can get a copy of the book there if they're interested.
Cool.
They can join any of those community events. They can try some of the Zend. They can eat a healthy meal or connect with some really meaningful people. So come help us build the movement and co-create it and amazing. Help steer the direction.
Beautiful.
I'm there.
Awesome.
Let's go. We're going there now. It's going to be amazing.
All right. Yeah, stoked. Thank you all for listening. As always, if you enjoyed this episode or any episode of Vancouver Real, please subscribe, review, share, like, comment, whatever, post, give us questions, whatever you want. We appreciate any and all feedback and connection with you guys. So thank you so much for listening. And that's all I got.
Until next time.
To whatever is.
To whatever is.